Good news, we're in the middle of discussion about hybrid and multi-cloud architectures. And this time we're actually gonna ask the question, is it even possible? So join me with Eric and Uli for another Armchair Architects. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show, where we'll be discussing the challenges you and our other tech-savvy customers have encountered. Together, we'll be talking with experts to find out how they think about these problems, recommended tools and best practices, and tips they've learned from years of experience that you can use. So today on the Azure Enablement Show, we're going to do something we've never done before. We're going to take our script, and we're going to simply rip it up, because we want to talk today about architecture. And architecture is a discussion. So we're back with Uli and Eric, and I thought we were done talking about hybrid and multi-cloud stuff. And then after we were done talking, we started to get into like a whole other area. And I thought like, oh, no, let's get this on tape. Let's actually talk about this. Because the question that we didn't take up last time is it even doable? Like, can you actually do a multi-cloud or a hybrid situation? Like, how do you go about implementing that? Like, so let's start with that question. Can you do it at all? Like, let's start with that question. That might be a yes or no question. What you want to vote on this, Uli and Eric? Can you do this at all?
So my vote is you can do it, but it does require effort and diligence.
Okay. Eric, is this doable for you?
I think it's doable. And in fact, there are offerings from us and other clouds to make this possible, like the Azure Security Center, onboarding multiple cloud resources into a single pane, especially when it comes to like, you know, what gives me a headache around this is authentication or authorization when you've got two separate identity stores and you're trying to build an app that crosses these clouds. Like that's challenging.
Well, I know we have the ARC stuff, so let's get into the challenges and the implementation details here, right? Okay, so you just said authentication and authorization is a big headache. What else is a big headache in this scenario?
Let's start at the basics, David, because authentication is something that is obviously very important, and we can certainly talk about it. But let's start at the basics. How do you build the software? So you're a software architect. You're deciding. You need to run in multiple environments because you don't know if you stay in one cloud and move into another, or you might have to take parts of your application and run it inside a telco cloud because of latency concern. Let's take that scenario. How do you do it? Well, the good news is that the industry has come together in a forum called the Cloud Native Compute Foundation, the CNCF. And the CNCF has standardized with the work of Google, Amazon, SAP, Microsoft, IBM. I don't know how many people have been working, a number of things. Most people will know containers. Most people will call them Docker containers, but they're now officially called OCI containers. And that is a standard that the Linux Foundation and CNCF are both driving. The second thing that the CNCF has standardized is a thing called Kubernetes. So Kubernetes as an orchestration environment, as what I call it, I would call it next generation infrastructure that effectively allows you to say, okay, how do I manage multiple servers, bring them together? How do I do high availability and so forth? So Kubernetes does that. Then there are things like service mesh, which is a network architecture of how you run within your cluster, how you isolate certain network capabilities and so forth. So the CNCF has a number of initiatives that are at various stages of maturity. But the great news is that you can get Kubernetes environments everywhere you go. And they are all CNCF compatible. Some are less compatible than others, but at the end of the day, there is a basis you can stand on, which I personally believe is a very important piece. And so we at Microsoft call that cloud native. So we support cloud native capabilities in Azure, in our hybrid offerings. And of course, we manage those as well. So that's building block one. How do you get to a CNCF model, again, supported by the vendor of your choice?
Let me ask a question about that.
Yep.
So you just said cloud native, but not clouds native. Like last I looked, like Kubernetes is not, I don't remember if the federated stuff went anywhere with Kubernetes. Like there was going to be Ubernetes once upon a time. So can't you get like Kubernetes sprawl? Congratulations, I've got a bunch of Kubernetes running all over the place and it's just the next level up of sprawl? Or is that what your number two is?
Well, again, for me, that's an operational concern. I'm still on how do I build the software.
Okay, sure. Okay,
but so it's a very important thing, and we should have another edition of this call where we talk about how do you manage all this stuff.
Okay, fair enough.
And secure it.
There's a concept called GitOps. I'll just give this teaser that allows you to manage a number of Kubernetes environments because we have clients that have hundreds or thousands of these things. And certainly needs a management strategy that is scalable as well. So I'm still building software though.
Yeah, let's get back to building. I'm sorry about that.
CNCF is the first base, but CNCF is mostly infrastructure focused. So as an app developer, I can now package my application and using DevOps tools, get it into a common environment. Great. But how do I build it? Now I'm running, let's say, on Cloud A that uses secrets management in this way. And in Cloud B, I use secrets management in another way. And all of a sudden, I have to write two pieces of code. I don't want to do that. And you have two choices. You can go with open source models like HashiCorp's Vault to stick with the secrets example. Or you can use an abstraction capability that we call Dapr, D-A-P-R, the Distributed Application Programming Runtime. And if you're interested, you can go to dapr.io and read all about it. But the idea is that you write your application to the Dapr API, and the Dapr API has services like secrets management or state management or stuff like that. And we and the community effectively build connectors to the implementation of secrets management in Cloud A, Cloud B, and so forth. And we have seen great success with Dapr with a very number of customers, and we are looking. It's an open source initiative, and we're looking at bringing that into CNCF as well, so that it becomes part of this whole package of cloud native technologies, because you do need to solve a number of common problems. And today, everybody does it themselves, figuring it out. And Dapr is one building block that effectively enables you to do cloud multiple environments in a very native way. So you write to the API, and there is a provider underneath.
Can I ask a question about that one?
Sure.
I don't know if you had more than two. This idea of write once, run everywhere, I've heard that somewhere before.
Yep.
I'm not sure if I can remember where. So I'm just wondering, like, have we learned anything from that exercise around Dapr and trying to build stuff for multi-clouds that we're like, oh yeah, okay. We learned, you know, we were naive when we thought we could do that before, but now we have a better idea. How does that go up one level from what we used to call, you know, from that place?
Dapr is, I think, a very clever design in the sense of A, it's modular. So it's not a set of monolithic capabilities. So you can just, if you say, I only need secrets management, then you only get secrets management, which I think is really important. The other piece that the Dapr team has done and the Dapr community has done is effectively, how do I live in multiple environments? While Kubernetes is the environment of choice, it's not the only environment. My friend Eric is in the IoT business, and we do have an IoT runtime. And so getting Dapr to run on non-Kubernetes environments is equally important. And so write once, run everywhere is broader than quote unquote, just rely on Kubernetes. Kubernetes is a great choice. Don't get me wrong here, but it's not the only choice because again, IoT scenarios and other things might still be out there. So we have learned a lot by making it modular and making it adaptable to multiple environments.
Well, the other thing I think about Dapr that's great, and again, not to plug this one, you know, framework, but it does a lot for you. It's very convenient. Everything from service invocation to state management to binding to microservices to the secret secure, even messaging, right? So there's a lot of productivity to be had in building this application as part of a multi-cloud deployment that it abstracts away from all the difficulty and all of the plumbing associated with managing secrets and things like that. So it is, as much as a functionality architectural abstraction, it's actually a productivity enhancement that allows you to quickly build, deploy, and spend time writing code that's actually of value to you rather than plumbing or non-functional code.
Yep. And the last element, and again, this is something that will come from multiple vendors over time, is that capabilities, that used to be bound to a specific cloud, let's say functions, are now becoming portable. So for example, Microsoft, we are taking a lot of our application development capabilities like Azure Functions, Azure Event Grid, and those kind of things, and making them available on top of Kubernetes. So you can effectively write your application in Azure, use the capabilities, and then conceptually speaking, right click on the application in the Azure portal and saying, I would like to package this up. So you get a package of the application, including the dependency like the Azure Functions runtime. And then you can take this package and, for example, go to GKE on Google, on GCP, and run the application on that. And we have a number of services. We call that cloud consistent. Azure application service like Functions, Logic Apps, Event Grid, and those kind of things. But we also have our database services, SQL Server, Postgres. We do our Azure machine learning capabilities on Kubernetes. So we are trying to make sure that our clients can build applications using the basis of CNCF, augmented with community initiatives like Dapr. And then the last building block is capabilities that are built that are built for Azure, made available on other environments so that we can support this in-car scenario, the in-factory scenario, but also the scenario of actually I need to run this in GCP for regulatory reasons and so forth. So for me, those three come together in order to really make the solution possible. Again, you still need to be diligent. You still have to think through what are the dependencies I'm willing to take, what are the abstractions I want to use, and so forth.
Okay, there's also a key component here, though, about observability, security, like transitioning to the operational side of things, which I don't think we'll have time to touch on in this session, but we should talk about like observability, security, lifecycle operations, deployment, all the operational components to figure out, well, who's down and whose fault is it? And then how do I fix it? And how do I make it more reliable? And then so we should also talk about observability anti-patterns, which I've seen.
Okay, well, that's a good teaser. I'm happy to stop there and to come to those things. Because I was just about to ask you, I was about to try to take this full circle and say, cool, I understand very now clearly Uli, what the vision is for how we build it. But what I now don't understand is like, does Dapr do all the right things about reliability? Or is that not Dapr's problem? You know, like, because we had talked about that in an earlier thing. So the next question I think is like, okay, now we've got it built. Let's talk about the running and the steady state situation, which gets us directly into the observability stuff. Yep. So why don't we take that up in a separate conversation?
Perfect. Looking forward to it, David.
Okay, well, we're deep in the middle of this conversation. I really hope you'll join us on the next episode where we pick up right where we left off. Join us again on the Azure Enablement Show.